Welcome to Mastering the 7 Hidden Secrets to Motivation. Before we get started, let me go over just a few items. First of all, as you probably noticed by now, there are 10 CDs in this program. The first 7 CDs walk you through each of the 7 Hidden Secrets to Motivation, one secret at a time. The last 3 CDs cover 3 areas that I consider to be critical to your success in mastering the system on motivation. Now, for a revolution to take place in your motivation, there's a process that needs to happen. To make things easy, I've broken this system into just 3 simple steps, and they are deconstruct, pivot point, and then reconstruct. The way it works is something like this. First, something gets you out of equilibrium. It disorients you a little bit and causes your motivation to reach what I call dissonance. Basically, dissonance is what happens when you see a gap between your intentions and your actions. Your intention could be, for example, to exercise, but your actions might be to watch TV. That gap is where it all starts. It's where you realize that things are not working the way they should be. Good intentions aren't connecting where the rubber meets the road. You know, for you to continue in the process, the next step is you'll need to at least temporarily set aside your old way of thinking until you see if another way serves you better. That's what starts the process of what I call deconstruction, which is the first step in our 3-step motivation system. Deconstruction happens because you realize that your current paradigm or perspective is not working well enough to get the job done. So you start to reconstruct something else in place to get the results you're looking for. Now, secrets 1 and 2 are dedicated to helping you work through the steps of deconstruction. Secret 1 is focused on helping you manage your perceptions and be more willing to adjust to the truth and the way things really are in reality, as opposed to the way you wish they might be. It also focuses on getting you to realize that we're all pretty biased when it comes right down to it. You know, we see what we want to see, don't we? The Gestalt psychologists like George Stratton and Harvey Carr both proved this was the case a few years ago when they tried an interesting experiment. They took goggles and put it onto people with inverted lenses designed to see the world upside down. Would you guess what happened? You guessed it. A dissonance occurs, and then a crisis of sorts, and then finally, believe it or not, the world is turned right side up again. But basically, the brain made sure that the eyes adjusted to see what the eyes expected to see. Okay, now once you have some dissonance, then a crisis of belief occurs. You just don't believe in what you're experiencing for a while. It's very disorienting. And let's say you read statistics that prove that there's no link between money and happiness, for example. At first, you might try and fight that conclusion. And then you might go into a crisis of belief and wonder things like, well, what if it's true? In this step of the process, you've got to uncover your subconscious limiting beliefs and learn how to reframe those to align with reality. Now, after that comes the pivot point, hidden motivation secret 3. You've deconstructed your old way of looking at things and taken it completely apart. Now comes the next step in our motivation process. You arrive at the pivot point, your moment of truth. This is the step where you have to really decide whether you want to adjust to your new reality or go back to looking at the world the same old way. Since this step involves a decision, it requires commitment from you. And that commitment usually triggers some kind of existential crisis. By that, I just mean you start to waver back and forth between what is real and true and what you formerly thought was real and true. It usually sends you into some places that you don't want to go, like a fear of not growing, or even worse, of not being, or a feeling of non-existence. See, every time you're faced with a major choice to align with the new reality, it requires 2 things at the same time. You're affirming something on one hand, and on the other hand, you're negating something. You're moving towards something, and at the same time, you're moving away from something. You know, the truth is, in most cases, it's really hard to negate our old reality because it's so well-formed and it's a pattern of habit. Have you noticed that? It's pretty ingrained, isn't it? It's probably become very much a subconscious process. Now, To move on in your motivation, you have to make the decision at the pivot point to begin the process of reconstruction. At least temporarily, the new reality is embraced over the old reality. And once that decision is made, then your old subconscious habits will try and pull you back towards the old reality. It's kind of like you're fighting against gravity, like fighting to swim upstream against the tide. And this is why the next stage requires you to experience and overcome resistance. You know, if you can learn how to overcome the resistance using your courage and the warrior's mental force, then you're ready to keep on moving in your motivation. But you have to learn how to delay gratification instead of using instant gratification. You have to learn how to negate the negatives and how to get rid of negative thoughts. And that's what Hidden Secret to Motivation 4 is all about. In short, you have to master keeping your focus on what you want to focus on. Now, after that comes the stage of integrating your intention with your desired behavior. This requires you to keep focusing your brain until the new foundation of your new reality is reconstructed. You want to lay the foundation for the reconstruction process, so you're well on your way to completely reconstructing your new reality. And this is the focus of Hidden Motivation Secret number 5. The effect here is a synthesis of mind and body when you're working together on the same page. The last stages of the reconstruct process mandate that you continue to build our new reality upon the foundation you've laid for it by using both positive and negative emotions to fire up your new reality and melt away your old reality and add light to your vision for your new reality and add darkness to your old reality. And that's what Hidden Motivation Secrets 6 and 7 are all about. So just remember, deconstruct your old reality, pivot at the pivot point by creating a new focus and intention and commit to it, and then last, reconstruct that new reality to make sure it's grounded firmly and fueled and refueled on a continual basis. Okay, along with Secret 1, you need to learn how to manage reality and perception. This means you have to be able to step aside from your natural way of perceiving things and become a detached, neutral observer of what's going on in your processing and in your thinking. See, most of the time, our brains run on what I call autopilot or automatic default. And that just means we just don't pay attention to the background of things. We choose to focus on a very tiny part of reality. This creates what we call bias. Bias is something hard to lose, but absolutely necessary if you want to create a revolution in your motivation. Bias just means that you cling to your own version of reality in spite of all kinds of evidence that contradicts it. See, you're only getting a piece of the context or the larger picture. Now, one of the things I'm going to suggest to you is to go out and rent and watch the movie by James Cameron called Titanic. And as you're watching this movie, I want you to write down in a journal every time you see bias, oversight, pride, and blind spots when it comes to decision making. For example, one thing you might notice is that they didn't load up many rafts, okay? In fact, they didn't have enough for everyone because it was inconceivable that the Titanic might go down. They also didn't build the dividing compartment walls high enough because they never foresaw a situation where it would be necessary to have dividing walls. They thought they were unsinkable, and so they were not really open to evidence that countered their way of thinking. They didn't heed the warnings about icebergs. They didn't take those warnings seriously either. They didn't take the fog seriously. Some never even entertained the thought of sinking until seconds before the ship went down. In short, their decision-making processes were flawed because they made decisions based on bias. As a result, their decision-making processes weren't based on reality. So how about you? What are the biases? What are the paradigms? What are the assumptions about motivation that you feel so sure of? What motivation theories do you really embrace? Should you be so sure? Is there any evidence that might counter those assumptions? How far have your assumptions on motivation gotten you so far? Are you really where you want to be? Is it working? Is your system doing the job of turning your intentions into action? You know, you might try a fun exercise. I want you to write down all of the things you've been taught, the books you've read, and what you've heard about how to increase your motivation so far. List them all. Rate your confidence in them on a scale of 1 to 100, with 100 being the strategies you have the most confidence in. You might find things on your list like affirmations, goal setting, willpower, positive thinking, personal power, self-actualization, habits and behaviors, negative reinforcement, reading books, attending seminars, setting New Year's resolutions, and many, many more. I want you to list everything you can think of, and I want you to take your time. Now, once you've done that, I want you to rate each according to the research and evidence you've compiled that these motivation strategies actually have been proven to work in the real world. Now, let me ask you this. If you could only use a few strategies that had to work in 30 days or less, or else you'd lose $1 million, are you sure you'd pick the ones you've already been using that aren't working so well for you? I mean, doesn't it seem a little silly to expect different results while using the same motivational strategies you've used in the past? That's what a part of Hidden Motivation Secret Number 1 is all about. I just want you to stop and take a look at how you are processing information. Start noticing what's going on in the background right now. How many different things can you hear and see in the background that you normally don't notice? I want you to master 6 things when it comes to managing reality and perception. Don't underestimate the magnitude of your motivation problem. I want you to magnify it instead by 100 times what you have in the past. Next, I want you to start moving away from certainty at this step and towards uncertainty. The next step, I want you to start tracking your mood changes before, during, and after a motivation bout. And after a situation where you rationalize away the action you intended to take, where you needed motivation. See if a day later, if your mood really did change. Make sure your goals are not so high that they demotivate you. I'll guarantee you that if the challenge is too high and the effort and the work required is too much, then you will not follow through with action. So last, I want you to start to notice your bias. Just become more aware of the information it keeps away from you. The last process you need to master in Hidden Secret to Motivation Number 1 is the ability to do trade-offs over time. Now, let me explain how this works. Most people focus way too much on the behavior they want to change. They fixate on something with very little motivation power, like a habit or an action. For example, it's kind of hard to get fired up about moving your legs while you run. Jeez, what a thrill! There's just not enough drama there, have you noticed? So we want to create some drama there to get you going by engaging your mind and your emotions in the process. And here's how it works. You see, when you set a goal, there are 2 levels to that. There's the low level of how-to, you know, the action step for how you're going to get it done. If your goal, for example, is to make more cold calls if you're in sales, then an action step would be to just dial more phone numbers or maybe to increase your calls or as simple as picking up the phone. Again, picking up the phone for most of us isn't all that sexy of a thing to do if you really want to think about it. And so that's why focusing on actions rarely does the job at motivating you. Why? Well, it did a great job at helping you to understand the actions you needed to take with your body, but it didn't address the motivation required to pull it off. We didn't give you the why behind the how-to. You see, the reason why is the second level to goal setting. It's where you lock in on the things that actually drive you into action. It's what I call the motivational drivers. Doesn't this make sense? Let's face it, you already know how to save money. Just put aside 10% of your paycheck every time you get one, and over time you'll start building a nice savings account. But let me ask you, are you doing it? For example, you might know how to lose weight, exercise more and eat better stuff and drink better stuff. But are you doing it? You know, the research has found that the how-to level actually means less to people than the reason why level when it comes to motivation. You see, here's the problem. The why level's pretty abstract. It's not real concrete, so we have a hard time setting it up properly. And the how-to level is much more observable and concrete and less abstract. So it requires less thinking, so we usually go the path of least resistance. Just remember, the more meaning you add, the more action you get. The more you can calibrate the reason why level, if you can get it just right, you won't have any problem following through on your action plan. Now, another problem is time span. See, the how-to level is more right now focused, where the reason why level is more long-term future focused. Try asking yourself, when you're looking at a choice, which one will be better for you in the long term and why? Come up with a list of all the really meaningful reasons why the long-term option would be better for you. Also, just be aware that when you're focusing on how practical and feasible your plan is, you're at the lower level how-to level. And when you're focusing on the desirability higher level, you're at the reason why level. So get in the habit of going for the choices that are future-focused, long-term oriented, that line up your desire and passion, that are more abstract, and those that you don't know exactly how you're going to get there. You know, I find it interesting that the more you focus on money, the less happy you are. The more you focus on success, the more it runs from you. And the more you focus on the reason why level, the more your soul is engaged. So I suggest from this point on, eliminate those motivation strategies that are a short-term quick fix and move towards those higher gear motivation strategies that are more attractive over time, more abstract, harder to achieve, more sustainable, long-term focused, injected with loads of reason why power, carries more motivation weight, and are more central to your long-term motivation. It's the difference between using a high-gear, dignified motivation strategy, like, for example, praying prayers of gratitude, as opposed to a dehumanizing motivation strategy like eating a can of dog food if you don't follow through. So, let's go to the list you created earlier of all the motivational strategies and start eliminating the ones one by one that would not make the biggest difference if you took it out. What you'll have left are the reason why strategies. And the more important strategies will rise to the top. I just want you to find that higher gear, and you'll never have to worry about motivation again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.